of all kinds come to live at the Minnesota Wildcat Sanctuary. When you donate to charity, you want your money used wisely.
It sickens me, and it's wrong, and she should be held accountable for her actions.
Wait until you hear what the founder is accused of buying her husband with donated money.
Plus, more taxes, paying for a major change to the way you commute to work.
And surprise, charitable gaming is up. Hear why the spike in sales this year won't help pay for the Viking Stadium.
But we start tonight with snow on the way. You don't have to worry about the morning drive, but how about the evening commute? Chief Meteorologist Dave Dahl is tracking when the snow will start falling. Dave?
You know, Bill, the latest computer run is in, and it does look like the timing is going to be about the same. The amount of snow may be changing, and I'll tell you that in a few minutes. But for the timing, we're going to call for maybe at 6 o'clock, kind of a mix of rain, sleet, and snow. It may start as early as 5, so just wet roadways there. Temperatures well above the thawing point at 38. 34 by 8, slushy roads there. The snow is going to pick up a little bit, but we could have some slick roads by 10 p.m. So after the polls close tomorrow, 32, yeah, the temperature's down to freezing. That could cause some problems. Right now, nothing showing up on radar, but that will be changing, and we'll show you that. Plus, how much snow should fall where you live? That's coming up in my forecast, Bill.
All right, we'll talk to you in just a couple minutes, Dave. Remember, you can use your smartphone to get your family prepared for tomorrow's snow. Download our KSTP app or log on to our mobile site to track the latest weather and traffic conditions. Leah?
Bill, tonight we're talking about some fast-moving buses. This is an idea that would change transportation for the entire metro. Now, before you say, I wouldn't ride a bus, note that you would pay for it with an increase in the sales tax. Take a look. Here's the current map. Blue is the Hiawatha Light Rail Line. Now, this doesn't include all the bus routes, but you can see green there. That's a Central Corridor Light Rail Line that opens next year. We also have two MinPass freeways, North Star, and one bus rapid transit. That's the red line, you see. Now take a look at the area. This could look quite a bit different in a few decades. Let this sink in for a second. I know there's a lot on there. You still see all those original lines I pointed out, the blue, red, and green. Plus, we've now added on the green line with Southwest Light Rail Line. And all of the purple routes are bus rapid transit. Those, you can see, are on nearly every major interstate from west, north, and the east metro. There's also a proposed light rail or rapid transit from the St. Croix River into downtown St. Paul. All of the yellow right in Minneapolis is possible bus rapid transit or streetcars. And they all intersect other light rail routes or bus routes, so you'd be more connected. Well, tonight, our Jay Coles is live along our only BRT, bus rapid transit route, in Eagan to break down the plan for us. Jay?
Yeah, Leah, now this line runs 16 miles from Apple Valley all the way to the Mall of America. Now, this station right here in Eagan is busy all day long. It's even busy at this time of night with buses rolling to the Mall of America.
Well, they call them light rail on wheels, and they aren't kidding. The drivers of these rapid buses aren't messing around, shuttling people in and out the doors as quickly as they can. Perfect for a guy like Benjamin Olson, who rides it every day.
It's really fast, it's really easy, and it's really cheap. You don't have to pay for any of the gas, you just pay for the fare, and that's it.
But taxpayers will pay to expand these rapid bus transit lines over the next decade. The Met Council says they're between $100 and $150 million each. And the head of the Met Council supports a half-cent sales tax increase in the seven-county metro to help pay for future transportation. The next rapid bus transit station will start right here at 46th and Hiawatha in Minneapolis.
And then move across on Ford Parkway, north on Snelling to Rosedale, called the A Line. We're set to open that and hoping for 2015.
And from there, the guy in charge of expanding BRT tells us these high-speed buses bring a whole new dimension to commuting.
Many of them do connect to the light rail system, other bus routes, and really the major destinations along around in the cities.
And the Metro Transit tells us they are not your parents' old bus.
Instead of stopping every single block, we'd stop every other block or every few blocks, so there's fewer stops per mile.
And to give you an idea how quickly these buses do move, we had one here just about 30 seconds ago, and it didn't even stay for 30 seconds. Now, in regards to that half-cent sales tax increase in the seven-county metro, Governor Dayton did support that in the last legislative session. However, it did not pass. But transportation officials and even Met Council leaders are hopeful that the legislature will look at that proposal again and pass it this year. Reporting live in Eagan, Jay Coles, 5 Eyewitness News.
Okay, so how about the gas tax paying for transportation projects? Remember, it was just raised from 20 cents to 25 cents a gallon in 2008. The state projected millions in new revenue, but those projections have been a bit off. Now look closely here. Check out the numbers you see on your left. That's how much the state projected over the last 4 years in millions of dollars. Go two columns over, and that's how much the difference was in projections and actual revenue. And you can see 3 of 4 years, the actual was less than projected, and last year it was off by nearly $20 million. Projections over the next 5 years are also going down. Not surprising, since people are buying more fuel-efficient vehicles and trying to drive a little less.
Well, the start of the new week is bringing new trouble for the president and the Affordable Care Act. It's about what the president said, what he knew, and when he knew it. Our Ellen McNamara is live in the newsroom tonight with the latest. Ellen?
And Bill, as this healthcare website continued to melt down, the president continued to tell people that other options were working just fine.
You can bypass the website and apply by phone or in person. I want to repeat that, 1-800-318-2596.
President Obama went on to say that it usually takes about 25 minutes to apply for coverage over the phone. But 10 days before the president made that statement, his own healthcare team knew that all applications were having the same problems. ABC News exclusively obtained an internal memo from the administration's healthcare war room, and it reads, the same portal is used to determine eligibility, no matter how the application is submitted. At the end of the day, we are all stuck in the same queue. Now, ABC White House correspondent Jonathan Carl asked White House spokesman Jay Carney about that internal memo that ABC News obtained, and the exchange was pretty uncomfortable. Listen.
These memos say that at the end of the day, we are all stuck in the same queue because they all have to go through the same portal.
John, I get it. But the person who calls isn't the one who continues to wait after the paper application is filled.
Your mocking is entertaining, but the president said that you could apply within 25 minutes.
That was
not true. So
you call up.
All right, so how many people have successfully signed up online or over the phone? Well, the White House won't say. They will say, though, that they will release those numbers in the next 2 weeks. Whatever they are, we will let you know. Reporting in the newsroom, Ellen McNamara, 5 Eyewitness News.
And we are watching a developing story out of New Jersey tonight. Police and SWAT teams are on the scene of a shooting at a popular Garden State Plaza. It's a mall in Paramus, New Jersey. The mall has now been evacuated. You see the number of law enforcement on the scene. Our ABC affiliate in New Jersey confirms with police that multiple shots were fired with what was believed to be an assault-type weapon. No word on any deaths or injuries. Right now, Paramus police have the mall surrounded. Again, you can see just the incredible police presence there tonight. We'll bring you any new developments as we get them into the newsroom in the next 45 minutes or so. Well, turning now to new developments in the deadly LAX shooting, ABC News has learned that the suspected gunman was dropped off at the airport by a friend who thought the man was flying home to spend time with his family. Prosecutors say Paul Ciancia was so intent on killing TSA agents that after he shot and wounded an officer, he went back and fired again, making sure he was dead. Ciancia was shot 4 times by airport police. He's recovering at a hospital. If he regains consciousness, Ciancia will face charges that could carry the death penalty. City officials are deciding whether to take action after a murder inside a downtown Minneapolis nightclub. Eric Connert's in the newsroom tonight with a closer look at the problems at Epic Nightclub. Eric?
Yeah, Bill, Sunday's deadly concert shooting at Epic is far from the first violent incident there. Records show police received 94 calls from Epic last year, 27 of them for violent incidents. So far this year, 65 calls, 6 of them for violence. And one of its owners used to own Karma, which closed its doors 2 years ago after the city labeled it a problem property. In the past, the city has imposed conditions on liquor licenses at problem clubs. It can also revoke them entirely. But right now, city officials are only saying they're weighing their options for Epic.
I mean, I think you shut it down. I think you've had this many instances, people have lost their lives.
Epic released a statement late tonight. They said they have the most extensive security screening in the warehouse district, and they went on to say, we have invested in metal detectors and security cameras. All patrons entering Epic are subject to search and security screenings. On the night of the incident, Epic employed 40 security staff members and 6 off-duty Minneapolis police officers. The city imposed 19 special conditions on Epic's liquor license several years ago, and City Council President Barb Johnson told us some of those conditions may have been violated. Live in the newsroom, Eric Connert, 5 Eyewitness News.
our future as a prosperous state could be in jeopardy. Over the next several decades, Minnesota's workforce is expected to stagnate, while the number of retirees is expected to skyrocket. Without a solution, Nick Winkler found out that the economy won't grow and promises to baby boomers will be broken.
That is going to be the link to your success.
2 weeks from now,
we'll get into the details.
Students like these at Summit Academy,
where you're going to direct deposit your paycheck.
Future carpenters like Adrian Weston.
Well, honestly, my future wasn't looking too bright.
We know that money in your pocket is burning a hole.
We'll shake their rocky pasts, join the workforce, and begin earning more money than they've ever known.
Well, I plan to be a very wealthy man so I can take care of my kids.
Because you've seen what your parents did.
Whether you know it or not, our future as a state, our economy, and whether we prosper, hinges on getting others like Weston to join the workforce.
Well, the issue is so pressing. It's why more than 100 people showed up here at the Guthrie Theater to discuss solutions.
My name is David Wilson.
And what the crowd heard is grim. Right now, the workforce is shrinking as a percentage of the population. It's expected to stagnate in the coming decades, just as the number of Minnesota retirees doubles to 1.4 million.
We in Minnesota have known about this problem. It's been coming for years, and we can't kick the can down the road any longer.
Our working age population.
David Wilson at Accenture says the achievement gap must narrow. For instance, 53% of students of color graduate from Minnesota high schools versus 83% of white students.
I remind people that we've never had the responsibility of managing a demographic shift.
Lewis King runs Summit. He says 40% of the workforce in Minneapolis will be people of color by 2040. Means they'll need the opportunity to earn more money, which will help keep the promises made to retiring baby boomers.
It's going to be worth it 2 more weeks from now.
Weston is excited to build houses, but if Minnesota is to prosper, it'll need many more just like him.
It feels great. It feels real good.
Nick Winkler, 5 Eyewitness News.
The unemployment rate among black Minnesotans is nearly 18%, and that is 3 times higher than for white Minnesotans. It's the biggest gap in the nation.
Generous Minnesotans donated thousands of dollars to a charity in need.
And she likes to use those cat stories to tug at people's heartstrings to get them to open their wallets more.
Now we have an independent audit. You won't believe how the founder of this cat sanctuary spent some of that donated money. Plus, it's not election day in Minnesota without some problems. The latest lawsuit that could change your trips to the polls tomorrow and in the future. And a charitable gaming boom in Minnesota. Why this is not good news for the Vikings.
Electronic pull tabs have fallen drastically short of sales estimates. But that doesn't mean that charitable gaming is down. In fact, it's not down at all. It's up. Guess what's leading the way? Well, Tim Cherno was live in Minneapolis tonight with the positive new numbers. Tim?
Recognize these. Don't think of these as losers. Think of these as charitable contributions. And we're at the Smack Shack on the North Loop. This pull tab table and dozens of others like it in the state are helping to contribute to bigger numbers, bigger money, and bigger charitable contributions.
Fiscal year 13 for charitable gaming was a very good year.
That's Tom Barrett, director of the Gambling Control Board.
We're up over 8%.
And still going strong. Barrett says paper pull tabs are pulling the heavy load.
Pull tabs, 90% of the business, 91%.
91% of $1.3 billion in sales for fiscal year 2013, which ended in June. Electronic pull tabs.
We've plateaued a bit. We're at 300 sites. Again, this is out of a potential 2,500.
Look at this list. These are new licenses for new locations participating in charitable gaming. Some with electronic, all with paper. Take Smack Shack.
Opened on February 8th, 9 months.
Smack Shack is on the new gaming list.
We currently have the Minnesota Tri-Wheel, and we also have pull tabs as well.
But no electronics.
No electronic gamble.
It's very busy. Very busy.
We're told some do ask for electronic pull tabs.
They have, but more so they ask us if these are for the stadium. And I tell them, no, it's for charity.
I got them.
And there's good news there, too.
The charities did a good thing in terms of increased sales. Minimize their expenses and increase their charitable contributions, you know, 21%. That's huge.
You want to know something else that's huge? What state is number one in the country for charitable contributions through gaming? It's us, Minnesota. We were last year. We're on track to be number one again this year, Leah.
So, Tim, the electronic pull tabs might not be huge, but is there anything else new?
You know what? Tom Barrett did tell me that there's something new. While everybody loves pull tabs, something is moving into bars that we normally think of as being in parlors. That's bingo. So you can look for bingo in a bar, maybe because it's growing in popularity.
All right. We'll be playing it soon, I'm sure. Tim Chernow reporting for us live in Minneapolis. Thanks. Bill?
All right. We're getting you ready for Election Day now. Tomorrow, voters in many cities will elect mayors, other city leaders, school board members. In Minneapolis, ranked choice voting will get its first real test. Here's a look at what it's going to look like. Voters will choose from a wide open field of 35 mayoral candidates with no federal or statewide races. We should not see a repeat of last year's long lines, but you do need to make sure that you know the location of your polling place. Some have changed because of redistricting. School levies will be big on the ballot tomorrow in several Minnesota cities. 83 of Minnesota's 377 public school districts will ask voters to approve property tax increases. 57 ask for money to fund general operating costs. 26 districts want to fund new building and capital bond projects, such as technology upgrades. State legislature boosted school funding by $485 million in the last session, but many school officials say that's still not enough to keep up with inflation and growing class sizes. Meanwhile, a group of Republicans is suing to block Minnesota's new online voter registration system. They say it was launched illegally and could throw the integrity of tomorrow's election into question. Three Republican lawmakers, the Minnesota Voters Alliance, and Minnesota majority argue Secretary of State Mark Ritchie overstepped his authority by launching the system. They say legislators should have vetted it first.
Online registration could be the best thing since sliced bread. It could be the worst thing since the plague. We don't know.
The issue here, ladies and gentlemen, is not whether online registration is a good idea. It might be a great idea. We don't know because there has been no legislative due diligence.
In a statement, the Secretary of State's office said that we do not comment on litigation, but we are on firm legal ground, providing eligible voters with common sense tools based on Minnesota law. And from the moment the polls open to the final tally of the ballots, we are your source for election coverage. Stay with 5 Eyewitness News and KSTP.com for election day information and results. A lot of you will be going to the polls tomorrow, but probably won't have to deal with snow or winter weather early in the day, will they, Dave?
That's true, Bill. It does look like it's going to hold off until almost the polls are closing. The roadways will be wet, though. The morning commute, no problem. During most of the day, no problem. But then the roadways become wet, I think, for that evening commute, and then possibly icy right around the time the polls are closing at around 8 p.m. So winter weather advisory, that just means conditions are favorable by tomorrow night for winter-like travel. And some of the roads could be slick. Not much happening yet here in southern Minnesota or western Wisconsin. Pretty quiet. We expect it to stay that way until later in the day tomorrow. The reason? It's still a long ways away. Here's the system. It's a big dip in the jet stream that's kind of carving out a trough of low pressure out there over the Rockies and just starting to show up some moisture in South Dakota, western Nebraska, and that's going to work its way in our direction. 37 in Blaine right now. Temperatures have dropped thanks to the clear skies that we have out there. Below freezing in New Richmond at 31, 30 in Red Wing, 34 in Faribault, and as you can see, 32 and even freezing up there in St. Cloud. Temperatures in the 30s just about statewide today, right now in 37 in Rice Lake, or 37 in Eau Claire, 35 in Rice Lake, and you can see low 30s up in the northern part of the state. So it's going to be a cold night tonight. Kind of sets us up for that possibility of snow during the day tomorrow. We're still at 39 in that heat island here in the Twin Cities. West-southwest wind at 3. So not much of a wind chill. 31 tomorrow morning. Still partly cloudy skies expected, but then the clouds really thicken in a hurry. 43 by 4, and shortly thereafter, we could have that mix of rain and snow start. 43 for our high, 44 in St. Paul, 40 up in Princeton. Looking for highs, though, only in the 30s out in western Minnesota. And again, the cold air is kind of in place to give us that snow. Cloud tracker overnight tonight shows the clouds increasing by 9 a.m. tomorrow morning. Still a mix of clouds and sun, but then during the day, wow, by 5 p.m., rain, sleet, and snow starting to pick up around the Twin Cities. But the snow, that's pushing out already by the early morning hours, and it looks like it'll clear by Wednesday, and temperatures are going to stay cool. How much snow we expect? Anywhere from around 3 to 4 right through the heart of the Twin Cities, 1 to 2 around that. But you get up toward the St. Cloud area and northwestward, not much expected at all. So it's a fairly narrow band of moderate to heavy accumulations of snow. 31 for the overnight low tonight. Mainly clear skies. Tomorrow's high only up to 43, and the temperature really starts to fall as that rain, sleet, and snow starts. 38 for the high on Wednesday, only 41 on Thursday, and then during the rest of the week, low 40s, some more rain, sleet, and snow Friday into Saturday. Kind of a messy affair, Leah.
And Dave, snow could get people thinking about the holidays already. In fact, for some Minnesotans, though, there'd be no holiday spirit without the help of local charities.
I don't think I'd have Christmas. Period.
Next at 10, hear just how many families have a similar story.
It was the final dress rehearsal for the Gopher men's basketball team. Plus, some Vikings players were questioning the coaches, what they're saying is ahead in sports.
Five Eyewitness News is presented by Minsure, where you choose health coverage.
Lower-income renters say they're struggling with rapidly increasing rents in the Twin Cities area. The Minnesota Housing Partnership says Twin Cities are seeing some of the biggest rent increases in 12 years. Average rent in the Twin Cities is right around $1,000 per month. Across Minnesota, half of renters pay more than 30% of their income on rent. Partnership says the foreclosure crisis created a flood of new renters, allowing landlords to be pickier and raise their rents. Now, some good news for American families. Big savings on the way for heating your home and filling up your car. Heating oil prices are already 19% cheaper than this time last year, and they're set to go even lower.
We could see heating oil prices drop 5 to 15 cents a gallon between now and Christmas.
Gasoline prices are 36 cents lower than they were 2 months ago and are heading down again. One reason for the drop is that hurricanes have been virtually non-existent this year, unlike last year when Superstorm Sandy led to fuel shortages. Well, with snow in the forecast, it's about to look and feel a little more like the holidays out there. Today, the Salvation Army kicked off its toy shop hotline. We got a look inside at volunteers and staff taking the names and information from families registering for help so they'll have toys under the tree.
Well, how many toys do you usually give out per year?
Usually, well, last year we gave out about 60,000 toys to about 30,000 children and about 13,000 families served. And this year we're anticipating a little bit of an increase on that.
From toy drives to holiday meals to the annual bell ringing campaign, we have lots of ways for you to get involved. You'll find all the information on our links page at KSTP.com.
And of course, when you decide you want to donate to charity, you do it because you want to help. But an audit now shows that some of the donations for these big cats didn't actually go to the cats. Coming up, the exhilarating way the founder spent some of the money on her husband. Plus, a border battle over school boundaries in the West Metro is likely to boil over tomorrow on Election Day.
It just breaks my heart knowing that she uses these cats for her own personal gain.
Harsh accusations and turmoil tonight at one of Minnesota's best-known charities. There has been a shakeup and now an investigation of the Wildcat Sanctuary. It's located in Sandstone. It's about an hour and a half north of the Twin Cities. It's one of 9,000 nonprofits registered with the state, and it relies solely on private donations to operate. Now, insiders are raising questions about where thousands of dollars went. Our watchdog, Beth McDonough, has this 5 Eyewitness News investigation. Beth?
Yeah, the founder is under fire tonight, and that's because of this report. It claims embezzlement and fraud. It says the founder was treating the charity's bank account like her own.
Take a look around.
A lot of animals here.
Cats of all kinds live at the Wildcat Sanctuary. It's the only refuge for these wild animals in the state. Each one is a rescue. Coming here after being abused or kept as private pets, volunteers make sure every cat has a name.
It's nice being around them. I like tigers.
And a place in the hearts of those who watch out for them.
There's no question about the care for the animals. There is a question about finances.
This longtime employee talked to us only after resigning. Although the staffer wants their identity to remain in the dark for fear of retaliation, they want concerns brought to light.
The money that the donors, the people who really care about the cats, is not going to the cats. It was going to her personal needs.
Titan is a Bengal tiger.
The staffer is referring to Tammy Thies, the founder of the Wildcat Sanctuary. Thies has been the go-to person rescuing cats and raising funds since 1999. Thies started small with just a handful of cats, and now the sanctuary cares for 109. She's seen the refuge through expansion, even a rare April snowstorm.
Obviously, the storm was devastating.
Cat enclosures collapsed. Animals' lives were reportedly at stake. Thies made an urgent pitch to the public for $100,000, money desperately needed to make repairs at the sanctuary.
And she likes to use those cat stories to tug at people's heartstrings to get them to open their wallets more.
Sources confirm more than $90,000 worth of donations poured in from good-hearted Minnesotans like this couple who wrote a check for $40 and a note saying this is all they could afford. According to multiple sources, it only took an estimated $5,000 to make repairs. They say most of the labor and materials were donated.
Because the Wildcat Sanctuary is a 501c3, which is a nonprofit organization, it must abide by certain legal standards, including some restrictions on how it spends its money.
Workers noticed discrepancies in the books, some small, some big. Staffers took their suspicions to the 9-member board of directors. It hired Dorsey and Whitney, a Minneapolis law firm, to do an independent investigation and put Thies on administrative leave. The document delivered to the board in June was so revealing, half the board stepped down, including the sanctuary's medical director, Dr. John Bailey. He offered free vet care for years. Dr. Bailey confirmed his resignation over the phone, but wouldn't go into detail.
It sickens me. And it's wrong, and she should be held accountable for her actions.
The findings from Dorsey and Whitney claim Thies violated her fiduciary duties, admitted commingling personal and business funds, committed embezzlement, fraud, and theft, even bought her husband skydiving lessons using Wildcat money. Thies has opened up to us in the past.
We don't need to create pets out of things that aren't meant to be.
But wouldn't open the gate of the secure facility.
I'm with Channel 5 KSTP Television.
To talk with us this time. According to the Dorsey and Whitney report, she also didn't answer a number of their probing questions. In September, Thies stepped aside. The new president of the board, Gail Plawocki, a longtime friend of Thies's, wouldn't meet with us in person, but acknowledged in this email a review several months ago and went on to insist a separate special audit several weeks ago concluded there's been no theft from the organization. Any such accusations are patently false. We have never misled donors. We dedicated funding to caring for the cats.
We want to make sure all our fellow tigers out there are taken care of.
This donor runs the University of Missouri alumni chapter in the Twin Cities. It gave $500 over the summer.
You expect a charity to be someone that you can trust with your money, and you take them at face value.
He's got more donations, but is holding off for now. That's what worries longtime sanctuary supporters the most.
We want the cats to stay where they are. We don't want, you know, the sanctuary to close down because of one greedy person. Tammy Thies is not the Wildcat Sanctuary. The cats are the Wildcat Sanctuary.
It's to keep the sanctuary going and to keep the cats here. We know that if something else happens, the cats are going to go someplace else. There even might be, because they can't go someplace else, some of them would have to be euthanized, and we don't want to see that.
And it's not so easy to move these cats around to another shelter. There are only 6 of them around the country. We also have some breaking news on this story. At the start of the day, Thies was the director of fundraising and donor development. But late tonight, she announced that she's been reinstated as head of the sanctuary. Plus, all but one staff member has been fired. Leah.
Well, Beth, where does it go from here then?
Well, we told you that there has been an investigation. There's also been an audit. I am working to get a copy of that audit, and I asked the board president for a copy of that, that she says clears Thies of all wrongdoing. She's refused to hand it over or explain what happened to money left over from that fundraiser, which is reportedly about $80,000. We have her entire statement on KSTP.com, and I've confirmed that the attorney general is reviewing complaints but can't tell us if a full investigation is underway. Leah, I also want to tell you that the AG's office investigates several hundred complaints about charities every single year.
And just so people who are concerned about the animals here feel a little bit better about it, the animals are fine. It's more of a problem with people than it is with the animals, right?
Right. Kind of some situations with people have been called into question, nothing to do with the health care of the animals. We should tell you that the Wildcat Sanctuary is fully accredited by GFIS, which is the Global Federation of Animal Sanctuaries. The director, Patty Finch, says it's passed rigorous standards for staffing and finances in 2012, a year before any of these allegations came to light. GFIS also points out that they have not received one single complaint. Obviously, very developing story. Mm-hmm. We will stay on top of it.
All right, Beth, thank you. Well, as for Minnesotans in general, we're really known known for being generous. In fact, we rank in the top 5 states for giving. Last month, the Minnesota Council on Foundations released a report that said foundations, corporations, and individuals gave $5.5 billion in 2011. That is 3% more than what was donated in 2010. And for those of you watching this wondering, how do I give wisely to a charity? And does its mission match my passion? Well, the Charities Review Council works to inform donors and help charities meet standards based on 27 factors.
It's a starting point. So what it means is, as donors, we should be asking questions and we should feel comfortable asking questions of organizations for whom we're going to be giving our valuable resources.
And to take a look at the list of charities that have gone through the review process, you can go to our website. We've posted a link for you.
What was supposed to be a quiet school board race is becoming controversial. It stems from the Parkwood Knolls neighborhood in Edina. Many voters there want out of the Hopkins School District and have formed the group called Unite Edina 273. A spokesperson for the group says they deserve a voice, even if it's a dissenting one. But some Hopkins parents worry that some of the school board candidates are supporters of the cause and don't want board members whose main motivation is leaving the district.
We're being told that, yes, you pay your taxes, and you're obligated to stay here, but you should never run for school board because you have an ulterior motive.
I think I'd rather vote for someone who has the intention of staying on the school board, not trying to separate from the school board and redistrict and split up the neighborhood.
There are 7 candidates and 3 at-large seats open in that race. A MnDOT worker's in critical condition tonight after getting hit by a car while out on the job. Police say this man, 24-year-old Jared Magnuson, had an open bottle of alcohol behind the wheel when he hit MnDOT maintenance worker Kenneth Moreau. Moreau has his orange emergency lights on here when he pulled over to pick up a mattress that had fallen off a vehicle on I-94 in Minneapolis. Magnuson did call 911. But he was arrested for careless driving with an open bottle and driving without a valid license. State Patrol says the person who lost their mattress is also to blame.
It has to be secured in a manner which keeps it in the vehicle. If that mattress doesn't end up on the highway, we're not talking about this.
This is the second time in 5 years a MnDOT employee has been hit while working on the side of the road. Well, in the weather department, the big story we've been talking about over the last couple of days is the possibility of snow, our first measurable snowfall of the year tomorrow night. And Ken Barlow is tracking that for us.
Yeah, Bill, we have the winter weather advisory now in effect. It's down from a winter storm watch. That's the hierarchy here. You have a winter storm watch, blizzard watch, winter storm watch, and a winter weather advisory. That's where we find ourselves now. Kind of a nuisance snow event coming. Yes, and tomorrow night's the time. The timeline is just ahead in the forecast.
And tonight's Wolves-Cavs game came down to the final shot after the Wolves were down 23 points in the third quarter. Plus, wait until you see the helmet the Gopher football team will wear on Saturday. It's ahead in sports.
Minnesota's own appliance specialist.
Welcome back. Let's get right to it. The storm is on the way. It's going to be a nuisance type storm. It's not going to be a major storm system, but for the first one, it's pretty decent size. Tomorrow, look for clouds to increase. We'll see the sunrise. We'll see the sun out in the morning, but the clouds will move in quickly after 5 o'clock. That's when the rain and snow start. Change to all snow tomorrow night. Slushy accumulations even on the roads, but it's all done by the Wednesday morning commute. So with any luck at all, it'll start late enough tomorrow toward the tail end of the evening commute to not have a major impact there, fall overnight, and then it looks like it'll be done by the Wednesday morning commute. So this is kind of good timing here. If you have to have a first storm, this is a good one. 39 degrees now in Minneapolis, 34 in St. Paul. Off to the north, there's our cold pool of air necessary to be drawn into the system, which it will be, to gradually change it over to snow tomorrow. Here's our cloud tracker. Tomorrow night, that is. 10 in the morning, still clouds moving in. A little sunshine still on the east side, but the clouds went out. And by 6 o'clock, we have a mix. That's the pink here. The blue and purple shades are the snow, and the green is plain old rain. It sits right on the Twin Cities for a couple of hours here, dumping, again, a couple to 3, maybe 4 inches of snow right across the heart of the metro. But look at St. Cloud, north and west, up toward Alexandria. Nothing. It looks very, very quiet there with a couple of flurries, maybe. It's going to be a very sharp line between where there is accumulation on the grass and then where there's accumulation on the roads. And then off to the northwest was really no accumulation whatsoever. And by the early morning hours of Wednesday, it's out of town. By the time it's all said and done, again, it looks like generally The healthy amounts will be across the metro themselves of Minneapolis and St. Paul, 3 to 4 there, only an inch or two in the northwest and an inch or two down to the southeast, with barely a flake in St. Cloud and Alexandria. Our forecast tonight looks like this: a nice quiet night, mostly clear, chilly, 31. Tomorrow, a little sun in the morning, fades behind the clouds. Look for a mix of rain and snow after 5, 6 o'clock or so, changing to all snow tomorrow night, lingering through the overnight hours, but gone by 3 or 4 in the morning, so that the Wednesday morning drive should be easy. 38, 41 on Thursday, a quiet day before another system, this one not as big, comes in Friday night and ends on Saturday morning. And it looks like by Sunday, skies will be clearing with sunshine once again.
In 4 games this season, the Timberwolves have already shown that they're not only going to be better this year, they're going to be more entertaining. The Wolves were playing back-to-back road games tonight in Cleveland. Kevin Martin continued his great shooting. He had 23 points. As the Wolves started a comeback, Kyrie Irving showed his amazing talent for Cleveland. He can really do it all. The Wolves trail by 23 midway through the third quarter. Derek Williams with a nice cut to the basket here. Puts it in for the Wolves. But J.J. Barea came off the bench and led the Wolves on a 15-2 run. He gets it to Corey Brewer, and the Wolves were within 3. 10 seconds left. The Wolves trail by 1 with the ball. The ball goes out to Kevin Love. He got a good look, but it would not drop. Besides Kevin Martin, the Wolves were 0-for-20 from 3-point line. That's how you lose. Great effort, though. Wolves lose it 93-92. It was another dress rehearsal for the Gopher basketball team tonight. They hosted Concordia St. Paul. That's Reed Travis of De La Salle in the middle there. He'll choose among the Gophers, Stanford, and Duke on Friday. Mo Walker is down 50 pounds from last season. He had 17 points, 13 rebounds. He'll be a good backup center for the Gophers this year. Junior college transfer Dre Matthew will be one of the fastest players in the Big Ten. He's really impressed the coaches so far. The Gophers win at 101-67, the first game that counts Friday night against Lehigh. Check out the helmet the Gopher football team will wear Saturday when they play Penn State. The Gophers will have the old red, white, and blue decal on to honor all military veterans. It might be a good thing that the Vikings have a short week. They host the Washington Redskins on Thursday. For the third time this season, the Vikings defense gave up a game-winning touchdown on the final drive of the game. The story has been the same all year, so I asked Jared Allen what the players need to do now.
Is keeping guys' energy and enthusiasm up for football. You know, no one likes to play meaningless football. I don't think we still have a shot. Obviously, go 9-7, you got to win them all, and you see where they lie. But obviously, we know with every loss, it gets a little more grim.
More tough news tonight for the Vikings. Tight end Kyle Rudolph will miss at least a month with a broken foot. Why were the Vikings defenders blowing a gasket in Dallas? We'll find out next. The Vikings have already lost more games this year than last season, and the season is only at the midpoint. There were a few players questioning some of the coaches' calls after the Dallas loss. Why did they pass with just over 4 minutes left instead of handing the ball off to Adrian Peterson? And defensively, the Vikings only rushed 3 linemen for a few plays in the Cowboys' 90-yard winning touchdown drive.
I don't take back anything I said yesterday. I'm probably going to get griped at for it, and in my honest opinion, I don't think I said anything out of line. You know, that's the thing we've always prided ourselves, holding each other accountable.
Every team has their issues. Even Aaron Rodgers of the Packers was jawing with his head coach a few weeks back. Rodgers was the story tonight as the Packers hosted the Bears on Green Bay's first series. He got sacked, landed on his shoulder, did not return, has a collarbone issue in the left side. Josh McCown and the Bears took advantage. He had Alshon Jeffries here, who gets both feet in. The Bears hold on to beat the Packers. The final 27-20. The Bears, Packers, and Lions are all 5-3. Next to the nightcap, martial arts with Mr. Potato Head. For the nightcap, what happens when you mix martial arts with Mr. Potato Head? So this guy volunteers to put a potato on his leg and let a martial arts expert kick it off his head. What could possibly go wrong?
Oh, no.
He missed the potato. He kicked the poor guy who now has a cauliflower ear. So at least he was able to mix a veggie in with that potato.
Oh, man.
I'm surprised he didn't get back up and kick the other guy back. Yeah. What are you doing?
It hurt too much.
They're probably brothers.
Right. Well, we're not kicking and screaming in the weather office, but you may be by tomorrow night. Slushy accumulations likely.
Thanks for staying up with us tonight.
Have a good night, everyone.